فإذا كان قطع الرؤوس وسبي النساء واغتصاب الأطفال ونزوح الملايين لم يحرككم فمتى ستحركون؟
History will judge us, and there will be no excuse for our failure to act.
نساؤنا تسبى، نساؤنا تسبى وتباع في سوق الرق.
They sold me from one man to the next, she says. The ordeal was even harder for the younger ones. They raped girls who were 9-10 years old.
When the US-led invasion happened in Iraq 2003, I don't think anybody could have predicted the rise of ISIS only 11 years later. A group of people that destroyed the social, physical, and spiritual fabric of the society. My name is Zainab Selby. I am from Iraq, and I'm your moderator today, and it's a very emotional subject for me. And I'm honored to be with two amazing and courageous women, Shireen Jabdu, a Yazidi survivor who faced all the consequences of the damages of war, and Ferial Riali, an activist, and today he's helping us as well with translation. So welcome them, please, with us today. Thank you. Shireen, tell me about your life in Sinjar before Daesh, ISIS, came to it.
The life was good in Iraq before all the ISIS happened. I was between my family, between my sisters and my brothers, even though we were farmers.
Life is good. Even though we were farmers, life is good. What happened when ISIS came? You were captured. You were one of the people that were captured by ISIS.
سی مها هشت سال مگرتن به عائله خوام یزدی همو هجی ام همو گرتن و که کم گرتین ام برین ام نفوساشین گالم همو جی قط کرین کچکو جنو میرو همو جی قط کرین
they captured me when we were running from ISIS to the mountains. They took me to Sinjar, a building that they did like documentary with the government. That's where they took me and they separated us.
They separated you from your family. So I understand there were 40 family members that were captured and now only 20 are alive or that you know where they are. Tell me more about that, the killing that ISIS did.
Yes, there were 40 and now 20 is captured.
And did you witness some of the killing in front of you, or what happened? How do you know?
تديت وقت الداري تتكشتين يا تنا.
أي ولا شنقال ده جاره هرب بريم قرتين الداري ما كشتن.
إد مالوا؟
نن إد مالوا ما بس إد ما مقرتي يزيدي المهر.
She witnessed some killings, but not her family. Some friends.
Do you know what happened to your family members?
تزاني شبيد وهاتينها.
ودست شتكي جين زان نالس نزان من ساخن نن مرين.
I do not know anything about them.
Now, I understand they tried to sell you as a slave first and rape you, but you pretended that you are married to your cousin. Tell me more about what happened.
پشتی هنگز جوان قط کردم از نپایی وی موس نمشی مش بروان مگویتش تکی من نکن سه هی واس نپایی وی موس نمشی مس کهرب کردم درمان اکبر دانا خناق مکا زیتی از نزنم چتش بو او پشتی هنگ پشتی وی درمانی از نیف بتانیا که گرمو تلق تلقا کل سر مرا بردان گوتن میکوچن ها کن نپایی وی نامش.
They separated her from family, and that's when she told them that she's married to her cousin. And her little nephew as her child, so they do not rape her. And she spent 3 months not eating, not taking a shower, not drinking anything, just so they don't get close to her. And then they took her to Syria, and that's when they wrapped her with a blanket, and they were shooting guns around her and telling her that we're gonna kill you, And they were giving her some medicine, like oil, they were giving her, and she doesn't know for what reason.
But did they believe you that you were married to your cousin, or I understand that they did not believe you, and then they killed other children in front of you?
They did not believe me, and they took him, and I don't know anything about him right now.
And your nephew?
U kurakshkata.
Brazil min nashmej dahat suriz bin shabsa asuriz bin ardi.
He came back. He got escaped from them from Syria.
And did they rape you?
The shola fiz darakre.
Na baz mahawla kirin. گیرو نکردن و مجال نداوان سه های واس نپایی موس نمشی من نخوار و من نفخور اش بر وی که از که هرب کردم و من هلا و که مکه مجاره که باز دا بشتی ما باز دایی از که هرب کردم و چرس نت پایی موس نمشی
They did not rape me. عملی
کردم الویداری الموسل.
They did not rape me, and I tried to escape once, and they got me. They brought me back and electrocuted me with electricity, and that's when they gave me the medicine too, and after she ran away and came back, that's when they electrocuted her.
So they were punishing you basically for trying to escape.
They did everything to me, every bad thing you can think of to me, because I ran away.
They sold you 5 times, I understand. Tell me more about that. How does the selling happen?
The fruit and pain jara.
Ah, yaki zit fruit me yaki goten go chaw go darawat ka wahat ka go na paivu na mashi go darawat.
Yes, they sold me 5 times. They thought I was lying. They believed I was lying. That's why I was not talking.
So what is? I mean, how do they sell you? What's the process of selling? What does each man do? In a market? In a court? In where?
چلو دت فروتن مثلا وقتی کی دات دایا کی سوکه دت فروتی نیات
نه نه اون سال جاری از سوری یا کیش موسیل هات از سوری کریم تختورک بو و پشتی وی تختوری از کریم مشوی سوری از ها از دیوجل مالا ویده یا کیزیت کریم هر تالی از باوی مام تالی هر دیسا ویز دیشوان کریم جاری کس فروتم و تالی دیسا ویز کریم.
So the first time I got sold was by a doctor. A guy came from Syria and by me. And the last time I got sold, it was from the same guy. The same guy bought me, was the same doctor.
When they sell, like for how much? What's the currency? It's money, it's cigarettes, it's food? What is the...
وقتی تفروتین چند وقت چه دانه تا چه پیدان دراف پیدان جغاره
و دب دلاره کی متفرود نیا کدوم؟
They sold for $1.
$1. And there is a market, or how? Just they just exchange in front of you.
So it was exchange, and he was saying that even for $1, I was expensive.
You were expensive.
Bahaya, arzan.
Arzan.
Oh, cheap. I mean, sorry. Cheap. Even for $1, I was cheap.
You were cheap. How did you escape at the end? How did she escape? How did you escape at the end?
شلوت خلاص ويتالي.
تالي فجاء ويتختوري أز نزب هني كاش يتخرب باي فيل كركوبون وأز خلاص كرم أز أنا ما رشيديش رشيدي أز أنا ما حاويجا نغلا بيرو كالد ما يدوان برداي أز جهاند ما وانو سبيرة هادم. أعرفوا موصل يكى جن زانيس خلاص بوما.
So the doctor, the same doctor that the last one bought me, called some people from Kirkuk to, and they came and took me, and she doesn't know how she ended up with her family.
So he just helped you free, basically.
Yes. وقت وان ويدختوري تدا شواني دير خابر كري تحاول عنا كدري وكدري.
الرشيدية وحويجة.
So they took her to رشيدية and then حويجة.
So they took her to areas in Iraq, but
yes.
But why did he choose to free her, basically?
I don't
know.
You don't know. Do you know his name? Do you know him? Anything about him? He's ISIS guy.
His name is Abu Fadl.
Abu Fadl. Do you ever want to go back? Now, where do you live? Where do you live right now?
Bajidiya camp.
It's a camp.
As a camp.
In northern Iraq.
In northern Iraq.
And do you ever want to go back to Sinjar?
Tadvita vagaria Sinjar.
Ode vagara kamanyahi da khushkid ma ubrad mal daste da'ish dana umnizalna sa'gna marina aw ya yani chal dari ma khushkubrad mal dari ma bukushnil la khashin gal damnu nikarin vagari. Uhi gundid mal daste wandana me cha vagari.
She can't go back.
Why?
I can't go back because that's the place where they got my family and they separated me from my family and my sisters and my brothers. She doesn't want to relive everything.
Do you have any support system in the camp? Do you have any other girls you can speak with? Other any support system that's happening in the camp?
ودي با ايدو اوجيد وكا من دست داعش در كتين بس بزحمته اعطانا كي يخسيرن ما دستي واندنا بزحمته الرجل مات بنص على الدقيقه كل ما بزحمته اعطانا كي يخسير الدستي واند
there are some girls but they're just like me escape from ISIS hand and it's hard for us every minute is a year every year is basically 20 years
now you also a Yazidi, and also from Sinjar.
Yes.
And you were telling me about a friend of yours that had gone through horrible story. Tell me more about what happened to your friend. Someone you grew up with.
Yes, she was my friend. We were basically in high school together. She got married. Unfortunately, I left Iraq in 2010. I didn't live anything. I was not living there in this situation. But she was in Iraq. She got married, and she was pregnant with a baby girl. Mm-hmm. And when ISIS took over our town, when they were trying to run away, because she was heavy, she was pregnant, she couldn't run a lot. Mm-hmm. So she told her family to leave her behind and just save yourself, go. And she was gonna walk slowly until she gets to where they are. But unfortunately, she didn't make it. The ISIS people got her, and what they did to her, they opened up her stomach, like from here to here. They opened her up, and they got her baby girl out. They raped the baby, and they also raped her.
And she survived.
And she survived.
Not the baby?
The baby did not make it. They thought she was dead. They left her behind. The ISIS fighter left her. But her family came back, saw her just like that, in that situation.
You decided to become an activist.
Yes, that's when I decided.
Tell me more about that. What are you doing here? What can people do with you?
I did a petition, as I told you about, back in 2014, 2015. I believe I got around 100,000 and little more signatures, just to do something about the situation and help the girls that are in ISIS captivity, just to help them and save them from their hands.
Mm-hmm. Shireen, I want to give you the last. It's not easy for people, women or men, to talk about such trauma. But you are speaking, you are here, you just came from Iraq yesterday, and you are here speaking. Why did you choose to speak, and what is your message to ISIS?
بجي أزانم زحمتها وكشترا ودهجش عراقي هاتي بجي تدوي تشر رسالة بجهين يواني داعش
رسالة زجهين ما داعش أمهر إيزي دينا وهر أمتركا دينو أوليت خنادن وهر أمي حياتها ماوية مستمر بي وهر أمي رابن أسرخو
The message I want to send to ISIS people is that we are Yazidis and we're going to be Yazidis. We're not going to change our religion no matter what.
And what's your message for people here who want to help, who want to do something? What is your message to the world?
ورابنا سرخوا زونا درنگ رابنا سرخوا بازارا زارو كد ما اتفجرين نهام زارن اكيد
My message to the people sitting and to the world is to save our people that is ISIS captivity. They're killing kids in front of our eyes and they're bombing them.
May God bless you. Thank you for your courage and may these tears change to a triumph of hope one day. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. Now let's take a look. Thank you. Let's take a look at what some women are doing. They're fighting back.
Every day I am taking revenge. It's a very shameful thing for ISIS that women are fighting against them. They believe they won't go to heaven if they're killed by women.
In August 2014, Islamic State fighters captured the city of Shingal in Iraqi Kurdistan.
The women and girls were sold as sex slaves, treated cruelly, oppressed, forced to marry and convert their religion.
Thank you so much. This is a film by Maria Bello, who is a longtime activist and a filmmaker, and with us today. Thank you so much, Maria. And with us is journalist Janine di Giovanni, who is an award-winning journalist and the recipient of the 2016 Courage in Journalism Award. Thank you for being with us. I want to start with you, Maria. What inspired you to do this film?
I have been an activist for many years, as you know, was in Kosovo during the war, interviewing women about rape being used as a weapon of war, lobbying Congress with women of Darfur to have a special hearing on rape as a weapon of war. rape destroys the fabric of the culture as we know, and it's been used for so long. And when I heard this story about a year ago through a business associate, I became obsessed with it. There are many women fighters in Kurdistan. They are a fierce, fierce country of women warriors. But in this particular case, with these women, with the Yazidi women who became the Force of the Sun ladies, they did it as a reaction to genocide and sexual violence, a direct result of sexual violence against women. And I wanted to tell that story, and in virtual reality. You see this on the flat screen, but the real piece, the 6-minute piece, is in virtual reality. So you'll be able to see 360 what's going on. And the words that I said in my voiceover were words from the interviews of the women.
Brilliant, brilliant. I have to tell you, as someone from there, I mean, it's just heart-wrenching to see the country that you're so familiar with destroyed, like just destroyed. Janine, you actually are one of the very few people I know who lived with Yazidis back during Saddam's time, because it was a very isolated and small community in Sinjar. And then you visited, and you're doing a lot of coverage on their stories now. Tell us, how was it before and how is it now from your perspective?
During the Saddam days, as you know very well, Saddam persecuted minorities. The Yazidis in those days were very, very remote. They lived near Mount Sinjar. It was very hard to reach in northern Iraq. Under the Saddam Ministry of Information, it was very, very hard for me to get permission to go, but I worked on it for months and months, and finally, I was allowed to drive up and go to their villages near Tal Afar. What I found was a community, an ancient, ancient people who were determined to hold on to their language, to their beliefs, to their black book, which is their religious, their Quran or their Bible.
They're a different religion on their own, yes?
Completely different religion. But they brought me into all of their festivities. I went to weddings, I went to funerals, and I felt that I was documenting. It was right before the American invasion in 2003, so they, like everyone else, like the Christians, like other minorities, were extremely worried about what would happen to them. So when I then went and covered the entire insurgency and the rest of the war in Iraq, and when ISIS began their assault on the Yazidis in 2014, I went back and I tried to find some of the people that I knew in the early days of Saddam. I found the Sun Ladies and I lived with them for a while. So looking at your film, it brings back memories because I found them. Of all the women, like you, Zainab, I've worked with a lot of rape victims in conflict from, we both worked in Bosnia for many years, Kosovo, Sierra Leone, Chechnya. I found the Yazidi women, we're not going to take it. We're going to form a militia. They knew nothing about fighting, even though Kurdish women, Peshmergas, did, but they wanted to learn. So they were getting up at 5 a.m, we would sleep on the roof. They'd wake up at 5 a.m, they'd start training. And the other thing that I really found extraordinary, and I've never seen this before, was the Yazidi men had a whole system of how to rescue the girls and the women that were held in Raqqa. And it was, I would sit with some of them and they would have on their phones, they would be able to see the auctions live on WhatsApp.
Oh my God.
And it was so horrible because they had to impersonate themselves as buyers. And so something would come up like, and here's a woman with 3 children and we'll throw in the baby for $7,000. And it was sickening to watch. But then they could identify themselves as potential buyers and they could go to Raqqa and rescue the women.
Oh my God.
So one small bit of hope, if you want to call it that, was that there was this response that I've never seen before.
That's true.
We're not going to take it. We're going to do something.
You wrote a fascinating article in Vogue magazine, and in it you talked about this American ISIS member. I found that fascinating. Can you tell us more about that?
One of the women who was released and who I met in a rehabilitation center in northern Iraq, she was held by an American ISIS guy who had taken up the call of the jihad and gone to fight. And the strangest thing about it was she said that after he would rape her, he would go and Skype his wife. back in the Midwest and have an ordinary conversation. Oh yes, how's little Jimmy? And I asked her, you know, could you appeal in some way to him? Could you try to get him, you know, or even through his wife, to get some humanity so he would release you? And she said, the wife knew all about it. And she was complicit in it. And not only that, the denigration, the way of, you know, these women, they're not women. And I've seen this, you know, so many times as you have in war zones, the way that you torture and rape and destroy a society is to treat them as though they're not human beings. Right. You dehumanize them. It's what happens to the Palestinians. It's what happens to many people in wartime. So what the ISIS rapists do is they just look at these women as objects, vessels. And I find that their strength and their courage, what she was just saying, you know, just is extraordinary. It's possibly of all the places I've worked on rape and on rape used as a tool of violence, the most disturbing and yet the most hopeful for fighting back.
Maria, you worked also on rape as violence, as a weapon of war. Tell me more about the patterns of that, you know, in your experience, how rape is used as a weapon of war.
Well, as I said before, it's been traditionally used throughout history to destroy communities. That's what we do when we rape the women. We plant our seed within these women. So that's what ISIS has been doing. But I would agree with you that this is some of the worst atrocities we've ever seen, because it's not only they're raping the women, but the way that these young women are being tortured. One of the stories that we have about a 9-year-old girl who was raped by 23 ISIS men over 3 days and died. You hear the story that this young woman just told about that woman getting cut open. These are only a few stories of many, many. And I'm really happy in the larger VR piece, you're gonna be able to hear some of these stories. So when I see these powerful women standing up, I can't help to think about Jung, when he talks about the animus, this masculine part of ourselves, this darker aspect that we don't like to look at. As women, we're traditionally known as nonviolent, you know, Mary, the mother, but there's this other side of us, Kali, the destroyer, the goddess, who's saying, no more. Women are revolting. You cannot have my body. You cannot have my child. You cannot. You cannot. And that's why I am so fascinated with these women standing up saying, you cannot have it.
Now, talking about that, I recently went to Iraq and I interviewed, in this case, an Arab Sunni woman, actually, who is taking it upon her life to fight against ISIS. Let's take a look at what she said.
زين ما تخافي لما تقطعين الروس؟ ليش تقطعين الروس؟ حتى أثبت للعالم إنه اللي يريد يدافع عن أرضه وعرضه يقدر إذا كانت عنده إرادة إنه مو بس الرجل يقدر يقاتل أنا امرأة وقفت وقاومت.
Wow. Great.
It was an odd moment as I saw that. You're like, okay, there's blood here. This is scary.
You look a bit stunned.
But they killed every single male member of her family. Yeah. And in ISIS, and Maria, you were talking about that, believe that if they killed by a woman,
they don't go to heaven.
There you go. And so these women are mobilizing and saying, okay, we will kill you then.
That's right. And, you know, the question is in our piece is also, who would you be in that circumstance? Right? There's one woman we interviewed who said she would rather have a pen for her daughter than a weapon, though she was held as a sex slave. There was another woman who has a sister, she's a Sun lady, who's being held, and she picks up a weapon. This is a Holocaust. Who would you have been during the Holocaust? Because this is a genocide. Would you be someone that picks up a weapon?
Mm-hmm. It's a tough one, actually, I have to say. Janine, yesterday there was a major U.S. Unilateral bombing in Syria. On a Syrian airbase. How does that affect The women who are captured by ISIS, as we heard before, the sort of, because ISIS sees the caliphate as both part of Syria and Iraq, and so they are mobile between the two. How does such airstrikes affect women who are being moved
back and forth?
Yeah.
I know that when people are held in Raqqa, the ISIS capital of the so-called caliphate, and there are airstrikes, usually what they will do is put their hostages as human shields in the front and center. And as you might remember, a young American girl called Kyla Muller, who had been kidnapped, was killed during a raid.
Yeah.
But these strikes, and I know this is getting off the subject a bit, are really important. You know, the war is going into its seventh year. I've worked inside Syria for the past 7 years, and I think it is finally giving some kind of hope and some kind of message to President Assad, saying, you will not be able to get away with everything. Mm-hmm. When there were the attacks in Ghouta in 2013, chemical attacks, which the UN said were the worst attacks in 50 years, President Obama backed out, as we know. The red line was crossed, he did nothing. That basically gave President Assad free rein to do whatever he wanted. Now this is one step, these missiles attacking the place where the sarin gas was released on the people in Idlib. But it's a very important message, it's a key message. It means that we're coming for you, we're watching you, you are not being allowed to act with impunity. Next would be the prisons, which are being used as torture centers.
Let's go back to what's happening with the Yazidi communities particularly. And actually, I mean, it's important to say what you said, because the damage of ISIS is not only Yazidis, it's Muslims, it's Christians, it's everyone, basically. Everyone who doesn't agree with them, they are destroying. How are the Yazidi community or Iraqi community looking at, in your experience in the ground, looking at the women fighters? Are they welcoming them, or how are they treating them?
You know, the Yazidis, because they're such a distinct and individual group, they're not Kurds, they're not Arabs. I asked a lot of them when they were running away, and their stories about running away were very similar to Kosovo people running away from the Serbs, or Bosnian people running away from the Serbs. It's always the same. You know, we took our children, we took our documents, and we fled. And they would say, you know, I said, what about your neighbors? And they'd say, well, they were Arabs. Mm-hmm. And I'd say, so didn't they help you? Didn't they warn you? And some of them did. Some of them did say to them, you need to leave now because ISIS is coming and they're going to take you. But others did not and were complicit in rounding them up and putting them into, you know, these kind of community centers where they were held. And then the women were taken away and auctioned off and brought to Raqqa. So, you know, you have to remember too, which you know very well, that Iraq is a patchwork of many, many different tribes and sects and religion, and the Sunni Shia divide is always very very pertinent.
We can talk a lot. That's a different discussion. But I have a hard time believing that the only way to sort of fight back is to fight back. There is other ways of healing. I'm sure not. You know, what are the other ways of healing in your experiences, Maria?
Well, you know, the traditional way of healing trauma. We, in IDP camps all over the world, and I've been to disaster zones, IDP camps, we have emergency medical facilities. Very rarely do you see something that's for psychological, mental trauma, which these women need. So the Shirl Foundation, which is a foundation that I'm working with Rima DuPont, using this particular piece and a documentary by Kate Brooks afterwards to bring attention, awareness, and raise money for actually the camp that she lives in near Duhok, to start the pilot program there for trauma centers for these women to overcome what they've been through. But I don't think that's the only way of healing. I think when you see the woman up there smiling that you saw, that you interviewed, when you know you've met these Sun ladies, there is a sense that they are healing through a different means, and that's using weapons.
What I like about that is that it shows a diversity of women, that we are not like this or this or this.
Right,
there
is
actually a diversity of women responding to different ways. But it is important to do something. I mean, besides hearing the story, what, in your opinion, people can do, Janine?
What you and I were talking about earlier, which I think is really interesting, is I've found that in the Yazidi community, because their spiritual leader in Lalash, I went one Friday with some of the Yazidi women, has basically come out and said, these women who have been raped will not be shunned from our community. And in some instances, I found in Bosnia or in Kosovo, the women who had been raped, because they were strict Muslims, and many of them were from the countryside, when they were raped, they couldn't talk about it. They couldn't tell their husbands. One Syrian woman I knew who was raped told her fiancé, he broke it off. So there was a kind of shame. And I feel with the Yazidis, the centers that have been set up in Dohuk for rehabilitation afterwards have been so extraordinary that there is a sense that they can be reborn and they can heal. And having this support from the men and the just the fact that the men are rescuing them, and also having the spiritual leaders say, we will embrace these sisters and daughters and we will help them be reborn again.
Well, thank you so much. This is like sort of the tip of the iceberg. Yeah. You know, there are stories now as Mosul is being liberated and as ISIS area is being liberated, there are stories that are now even emerging more of what women have gone through, Yazidi and beyond. And so to be continued and to show up in this time. And thank you so much for showing up and doing something. Thank you.